from LPI Studios in Memphis, Tennessee, it's R&R on Sports with Uncle Howard, Howard Robertson.
Everybody that is in a leadership position is not necessarily a leader.
Jenny on the block, Jennifer Conroy.
It's a standoff now between Phil Jackson and Carmelo Anthony, and so I think they've put out there that he's being shopped.
And the magnificent, tremendous, undeniable, undisputed, supercalifragilisticexpialidocious, Larry Robinson.
Nerlens Noel going to Dallas from the 76ers. Yeah. He was asking to get out of there. They really got a log jam in the front court.
It's R&R on Sports.
Hello and welcome to R&R on Sports. I'm Uncle Howard.
And I am the fantastic, the amazing, the extraordinary, the coolest, the funnest,
the peculiar.
What's up, America?
The special. What's going on?
What's happening, man? Happy weekend to
Robinson.
You, brother.
Thank you. You too, and you too. Oh,
man, we got to talk about a few things, but I want to make sure just kind of give everybody a pre-warning. We're going to talk about Russell Westbrook because we both went to the game. So y'all just get ready for this conversation
on who the MVP is. In the meantime, before we get to that, we have to talk about everybody, I'm sure, saw the finals and the final four before that. And if you listen to this broadcast, you know that I predicted Gonzaga was going to be the new national champ, and I was wrong.
I picked North Carolina.
Yeah, you picked a lot of people.
I finally picked Frank Martin in South Carolina and ended up striking out again.
Sure did.
I mean, this has been the worst March Madness for me. I mean, I don't think I got one pick right.
Well,
I don't think I got
the finals was a battle. Right. It was a battle.
It was a war.
And, Gonzaga missed opportunities.
Let me ask you, do you think the officials played a big role in it? Because that has been some of the feedback that I've heard since the game.
Yeah, but I don't think not in the outcome.
Okay.
I don't.
Okay.
You know.
Now, who stood out to you? Who really made you feel like, okay, I can see this kid at the next level?
Yeah, from Williams Goss.
From Gonzaga.
Gonzaga.
Absolutely. I can see him playing at the next level.
Is going to love, and I hope he stays healthy, he's going to love this big kid.
What's his name?
It starts with a K. That's all I can tell you. I'll find it. But
Koswarski.
Big kid. And he is, but, you know. So I think most everybody on the floor. What's the North Carolina State kid?
But no, Justin Jackson.
Justin Jackson,
man, I think is the truth. I think he's going to be a major, major success at the next level. He's about 6'7", 2 or 1. He actually could probably play a little one. Now the person that I was least impressed with is Joe Barry. I've not been impressed with him. Now, he's had some great games, obviously, but I think he needs to hang around another year. But talking about those kids hanging around another year, if we can transition, it's a mass exodus out of the NCAA ranks this year. I mean, you probably had about 20 players, but you got four coming from University of Kentucky. You have three coming from UCLA. I mean, it's a lot of players. And
your question is back at you. Do you see them at the next level?
Who, the four?
No. I mean, the host of people that will be declaring for the draft.
Absolutely. I can see Markel Fultz in the next level. I can definitely see De'Aaron Fox. Love this kid, Malik Monk. And if you haven't seen the Players Tribune, or if you haven't read the Players Tribune article that he wrote, kind of saying thank you to his hometown, thank you to the Big Blue Nation, do yourself a favor, pull up, you know, grab some coffee, sit back and kind of read that article. Says a lot about the young man. Very impressed with Malik Monk. Bam Adebayo, I see him going. The kid Robert Smith, I think, is awesome. And Lonzo Ball, I think he's definitely one or two pick. You have a few players that I think will do very well. This year.
We're going to talk a little bit more about that. And we got Russell Westbrook. We're going to talk about
Patrick Ewing.
We got to talk about Tony Romo. We got to talk about a lot of stuff. Don't go anywhere. Get your laugh on. We'll be back with more R&R after this.
Hey, this is Ice. I'm the original gangster. Whenever I'm hanging out with Coco, when we just chilling on the Saturdays, we're always listening to Howard and Larry on our On Sports. You know what I'm saying?
I am a nightmare walking, psychopath talking. King of my jungle, just a gangster stalking. Living life like a firecracker, quick as my fuse. Vendetta's a death, back the colors I choose. Red or blue, cuz of black.
Hey, Larry, you got an emergency call? It sounds like you're Uncle Ragus.
Hey, Uncle Ragus, how you doing?
Not too good, nephew.
What's wrong? You sick? You don't sound like you feel well.
Well, that's cause I'm tired, and I'm ready to come home.
Come home? Come home from where? Where are you?
Well, that's the thing right there. See, I don't know exactly where I am. It looked like an island somewhere, because I ain't seen nothing but sand, palm trees, and the ocean. But I don't know which ocean.
Wait, didn't you know where you were going? How the hell did you get there, and who are you with?
Them's all very intelligent questions, nephew. And I should have some answers.
I certainly hope so. You need to hurry, because I'm in the middle of a daggone show, man.
Now, you remember a couple of months ago when I was talking to Shelly?
Shelly? Shelly who? Oh, Donald Sterling's wife, Shelly Sterling.
Yeah. And you know they closed the deal on the team.
Mm-hmm.
So she got paid, and she done kidnapped me, flew us down here wherever we are, and she making me do things. This old girl is a freak. Shh. Here she come.
Ragus. Why are you Ragus, boo? You're not done yet, sweetie.
Oh, Lord, I'm so tired.
See, I remember you talking about what you were going to do to her. But sounds like you getting done. Y'all running around naked on the beach?
Naked as a damn jaybird, and these sand crabs been tearing my ass up. See, she's sore, and she can't get enough.
Too much information, huh? I really don't need to hear no intimate details.
Ain't no intimate detail. I said she's sore, S-O-R. That means she sprung on Ragus. I can't let her find me.
There you are, Ragus Boo. Come on now. Mama's got something for you.
Oh, Lord.
I'm Allan Houston of the New York Knicks and founder of Fizzle, and you are listening to R&R on Sports.
And we are back with so much to talk about, and Karnowski.
Karnowski, is that his name? Karnowski?
Yes. Razemik Karnowski, 7'1", 300-plus pounds. You know, when you get my age, ladies and gentlemen, let me tell you, you can think about this. You can't remember exact stuff, but you remember the letter it starts with. So I said his name started with a K. It's Karnowski.
Man, let's talk about this MVP thing, man. Let's really unpack this.
Okay.
Now, let me ask you. Okay, the backdrop of all of this is that we went to see Russell Westbrook the other night.
Sure did.
Play in Memphis, Tennessee. So let's hold off.
Russell
on that.
Westbrook and the rest of the guys that are on the team that he plays with.
You talk about the Westbrook heirs or
goodness.
But honestly, my challenge when it comes to James Harden, I'm going to kind of break down this whole thing. My challenge when it comes to giving James Harden MVP is we've seen this before with a Mike D'Antoni offense and a point guard. Steve Nash. I don't think Steve Nash would be anywhere near the player, and he definitely wouldn't have won any MVPs if he wasn't playing in the Mike D'Antoni offense in Phoenix.
Mm-hmm.
Then you turn around and you have Jeremy Lin. I don't think we would even know who Jeremy Lin is if he didn't play in the Mike D'Antoni offense for those 2 to 3 weeks in New York.
Right.
Then you got Raymond Felton. Raymond Felton had a very mediocre career until he played in the Mike D'Antoni offense, and he was able to really extend his career and also raise his popularity and his name recognition.
So make the point.
So my point is that I think James Harden is just a better version of these players. All these players were really rather diminutive as it relates to the NBA. And now you have somebody who's 6'5", athletic, so on and so forth, still out in the point guard position in the Mike D'Antoni offense, and he's been able to do it. So with that, I think James Harden, although he's had a phenomenal year, I just don't believe that he has had a more phenomenal year than my choice for MVP. Now, when it comes to LeBron James, I think LeBron James, we just got brand fatigue. I think it's LeBron, LeBron, LeBron. He has to do something just sort of extraordinary, kind of in line with what Michael Jordan had to do. We know he's probably the best player in the league. So you got that.
We have to remember that the MVP is for most valuable player. So you have to take that in context. And that's all relative. That's relative to what the player provides, the value that they provide in their own for their own team in their own environment.
Well, if using that what you just said,
okay.
Kawhi Leonard should have more consideration for the MVP, because there's no way that the San Antonio Spurs will be anywhere near where they are,
right,
without Kawhi Leonard.
And I wouldn't argue that he should have higher consideration,
right?
But
the MVP,
nobody,
of this
absolutely,
league,
absolutely,
the MVP,
there's
of this
nobody
league,
more valuable to a team than Russell Westbrook and what he is doing. You and I both sat there last night and watched, and imagine what. And this might be what they will be. Imagine what the Thunder will be without Russell.
Nothing. A lottery pick. And would be competing for the most ping pong balls, period. I'm telling you. I mean, listen. Russell Westbrook should have had 20 assists easily.
Yeah.
These boys can't hit a shot.
Right.
I mean, Oladipo is a figment of what he was coming out of college.
Yeah.
I mean, he is not the same player. And when you look at Steven Adams and Taj Gibson and these guys, they played horribly.
Right, right.
I mean, they played horribly.
So
and
Russell
Westbrook, I mean, 45 points, 10 rebounds. I mean, 9 rebounds, 10, 12 assists. I mean, this dude is bringing it every single night.
No doubt he should be a lock. He should be a lock.
He should be a lock.
Let's offer our sincere congratulations to Patrick Ewing.
Absolutely.
For becoming the head coach for the Georgetown Hoyas. And you and I both have had, three of us have had this conversation about the chances which a snowball's chance in hell, in my opinion,
I think Patrick
of
does
Patrick it. Ever having become a head coach in the
well,
NBA.
I think he almost came close with the Charlotte Hornets. I think he almost, and that was because of his friend Michael Jordan.
But I think generally they didn't see him in that light. And
well, he's associate head coach, so they kind of positioned him to do it. Down in Orlando, I think I think he's been building quite a resume.
Yeah. But I'm thrilled to see him.
Yeah,
I'm thrilled to see him get an opportunity, and very happy to hear that John Thompson supported him like he did, and recommended him like he did.
Absolutely,
he deserves the opportunity. there's a huge shakeup. Has been a huge shakeup at the University of Memphis, which Tubby Smith is the head coach.
Yeah,
and three people who have all the same last name, Lawson, have walked.
Yeah.
An associate.
Coach. No, he's a player development now.
Okay.
He's a
okay.
player development.
Keelan Lawson, yeah, and his two sons,
KJ
and Diedrich, have decided to go somewhere else.
Now, mind you, that there's two more Lawsons coming. And
yes.
You have Chandler Lawson, who's
supposed to be the truth.
But he is. He's the truth.
He's the most valuable player.
I've seen him play a few times.
And he's what grade?
He was a sophomore this year.
Okay.
And led the team to the state championship in Tennessee.
Okay.
And the kid is awesome. About 6'9" or so. I mean, just a specimen and can ball.
Tubby has gotten a reputation of not endearing himself and reaching out to local coaches and AAU coaches and high school coaches.
Tubby old school, that he's, man.
Tubby is old school. Now, here's the question. Here's the question. And for everybody that doesn't know, the great Penny Hardaway is now a high school basketball coach in Memphis, Tennessee, and his East High School team just won the state championship.
Second time in a row.
Two years in a row. Now, if you were Tubby, would you indeed beat it over to wherever Penny Hardaway is and offer him a job?
Absolutely. I mean, I think Penny is the heir apparent to the University of Memphis head coaching job. And I think it would be right in line with you know, Larry Finch being a great player in University of Memphis, mm-hmm. then ultimately becoming a head coach. I see the same thing with Penny Hardaway being a great player. Jersey retired, the whole nine. He donates a lot of money to the University
of
Memphis.
Money.
And then the fact that he has one of the biggest selling shoes in the world, I think that adds a lot of cachet to draw today's players.
Okay.
Potentially those one and done players. So I think,
Coach Smith, Tubby?
Yeah, Tubby.
Let's get Penny.
Find
you a penny.
Let's get
Listen,
Penny.
Lastly, let's talk about Tony Romo. Tony Romo, say hell with all of this getting hit.
Yeah, because he's kind of fragile.
Later for this.
He's kind of fragile.
I'm becoming lead analyst for CBS Sports.
Yeah, football, man.
Football.
I think it makes a world of sense. You know, how long could he actually play in the NFL?
True that, yeah.
I mean, so he has about 3-4 more years if he played and was maintained relatively healthy.
What does that do for our boy Colin Kaepernick now in terms of consideration?
I think Colin Kaepernick was being considered as much as he's going to be considered. Everybody knows he's the best quarterback prospect out there. I think they're wondering if they can deal with the distractions and things that are coming along. And then I think, you know, I think the NFL owners are somewhat colluding to say, we're going to teach you a lesson. You're going to do this our way. You're not going to mess up our bread.
Okay.
So there we are.
It'll be interesting to see how that all shakes out. And speaking of us shaking out, we're going to shake you out another fantastic iConversation.
Allan Houston, we got part two of the Allan Houston conversation.
All right. So you can't leave. You can't go anywhere. Stay with us. R&R on Sports, back after this.
Chris Brown.
David West, Golden State Warriors.
Hey, this is Dr. J.
This is Shaq Adoshis.
Yo, what's up? This is Ice Cube.
This is Nicki Minaj.
And you're listening to a little R&R
on Sports.
Family's all that we got. Everything I would do, you were standing there by my side. And now you're going to be with me for
And here we are with iConversation and a great guy that has become somewhat of a regular here on R&R, although he's in New York City and we are here in Mayberry. But he gets down here and gets on the phone and gets with us from time to time. I'm talking about the assistant general manager of the New York Knicks and former all-star shooting guard,
and
Allan
founder
Houston.
Of one of the most amazing organizations that's coming on board.
You always
it's
gotta
physical.
Ask.
Yeah, because you know you leave ask. Stuff out, brother. You leave stuff out.
We were getting to that. Allan, welcome, man.
Good to be back, as always.
Now, here's how we're gonna get into that.
So you want to talk about Louisville a little bit?
Because yeah,
you know
we're gonna talk about
because he actually learned how to walk on the Crawford Gym floor at University of Louisville.
Because,
see, we
that.
Do that in Louisville.
I got that.
We ball that. Players. See,
you
we
putting yourself
players.
In that?
We ball players. You know, we on the court. You know, we on the
but
court.
But you were from the hills, Larry. You from outside of Louisville. He
nah,
had a
brother,
street in front of his house. You had dirt. Anyway, now, how was it indeed growing up the son of a legend?
Yeah.
I mean, because Wade Houston was a legend in Houston,
yeah.
in Louisville, and I mean, was there pressure
Man,
on you
know,
as a kid?
I didn't really feel pressure. I mean, I felt pride more than anything. You know, you know, think about it. This is your dad who is playing an influential, highly influential role in essentially guys who are your heroes. He's the guy that's kind of instructing and leading him. So it basically gave me such a respect for him that it was hard. I mean, obviously, you know, as you grow into your young manhood, you're going to have bumps in the road and disagreements here and there with your authority figure.
But my mother-in-law calls it going over Fool's Hill.
Yeah. So
some of us, roll over Fool's Hill.
Yeah. Yeah.
But some of us circle back and go over it again.
I did a couple of those laps. my whole thing was when I got to the hill and as I started to roll over, what it did is it made me think a lot longer.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah,
and that's
yeah.
that's what the relationship with my father was, is, you know, I got to see a lot of greatness that came from him, not just directly, but kind of indirectly from the players he coached. Mm-hmm. So by the time I was a high school student athlete that was starting to form my own identity, I felt, at that time I already had a healthy respect for what he had kind of poured into me, and just the whole situation, and his influence was big, but I don't think I ever felt pressure, because with him being a coach, my biggest pressure was more really kind of like, are you going to live a certain way and not be a great basketball player? But the pressure I felt more was I have to represent his name, represent the city, represent the Louisville
right
way, and so that to me was the pressure of living according to the name that he set forth.
This is R&R on Sports, and we're speaking with Wade Houston, his son. Allan Houston.
Right.
We're speaking about Wade, but I'm saying we're speaking to Wade Houston's son.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
No, I said we're speaking to Wade Houston's son, Allan Houston. Godly, man, what's wrong with y'all brothers, man?
I buy you books.
Listen, man.
I buy you books. I get you magazines so you can read up on this stuff.
Right. Too many pictures that don't know.
You embarrass me. Yeah, too many pictures.
Now, see, when we were growing up, the University of Louisville Cardinals were our pro team.
Right.
I mean, seriously. Right. They were everything to us. How much of that, seeing them train, seeing how much work they put in, was a part of your development as you became a great high school player, a great college player, and ultimately a great pro?
So I got a quick story. So I was like in seventh grade while I was in practice watching them, go up and down. And mind you, I realized the greatness I was seeing. I mean, these guys were going to Final Fours.
Right.
They were pros. They were literally pros,
Right.
So I'm watching this and watching Coach Crum and my dad and all these great players. One day they're running the end of practice, and Coach Crum says, "Allan, get over here." Said, "You got to make 7 out of 10 free throws in front of this whole team, or they got to keep running."
Whoa.
Seventh grade.
Now that's seventh some pressure.
Right? That's some pressure
that's some
right
pressure.
There. So, your heroes.
So when you ask me how much of my development was attached to that experience, imagine, that as a seventh grader, and I made my 7, and everybody was going crazy. But imagine how now you go from that to your middle school game, to your high school game, to you playing in the Rupp Arena, 24,000 people, whatever that is. That was very strategic from my dad and Coach Crum's part to build, no matter how good a player I was going to be, I was going to say seventh grade.
Right.
So they weren't trying to say, we need to make this guy next LeBron. They were saying, we got to build some values into this young man, some confidence, some mental, and that's
fortitude
really,
and toughness. Yeah.
Right. So for me, those were the valuable experiences that I take away from that. When I was a sophomore, as freshman, the guys would come back from the pros, Griff, and all the pros would come back and play in Crawford Gym. And when I was a sophomore, I finally got to play some games.
Really?
Now, my freshman year, they were throwing my ball on the other court.
Mm-hmm.
But now, my junior year, I'm like, I'm seeing them over there, like when we were playing pickup. Now, the year later, I'm like, they're over there, like, saying, "Who got out?" Wow. So you're really starting to see the progression. Like, you go from there, I want him here.
To them taking you seriously.
Who's going to actually guard him?
Yeah.
Right. You know, so it's again, the whole development, that whole process was huge.
Wow.
So all of those experiences and exposures, as I understand, came down and helped you form this
value
new
system.
Thing that you got.
Yeah.
Talk this about, new thing.
Talk about
this
that.
New thing.
This new thing.
Well, it's
you stole
it's,
Snoop's word, man. Go ahead. Go ahead. Tell him what's up.
Well, after we explain all this, y'all tell me if y'all think it's Snoop's words. Although he did support, and we did like this these shout outs. But what happened was, my father started. We started doing these father son basketball retreats, and we really wanted to. I really wanted. I told my son with the Knicks. I wanted to say, let's share all this, what we've shared, how can we package it and share it in a way that encapsulates our relationship and the message that I got. So I was just riding on the plane. I said, well, what is it that if I could kind of sum it up quickly in some words or themes, you know, what would it? And God just basically, literally, man, just took my hand and wrote these five words down and kind of put them into one acronym. So I said, well, let's talk about faith was one. Fundamental integrity, which is faith, was my mother was just all faith. Everything was faith, believe, trust. It's gonna be okay. My father was integrity. He was the guy's like, you got to do the right thing, make the right play. His father was like, just, you know what's right and wrong. So then I thought about sacrifice as the things that I saw them work so hard for, give up things that we could do. So faith, integrity, sacrifice, and then I thought about those kind of qualify you for leadership, right? And at the end of all that, you now have an understanding of what your legacy really is. So those five fundamentals of life were faith, integrity, sacrifice, leadership, and legacy. So we've kind of basically branded Fizzle, as these fundamentals.
For shizzle.
You can say that.
For shizzle. This is R&R on Sports, and we're speaking with Allan Houston about Fizzle.
That is very deep.
It's like a stair step, actually. And it's kind of, I never knew that they were tied together in sort of like a progression to legacy, and this is your legacy.
Yeah, when we take people kind of through the actual programmatic implementation, they go through the first three stages, and then we kind of take a pause and let them kind of say, all right, now you kind of almost like look at it as qualify you in your leadership role. So you kind of know, people say, what is leadership? Well, okay, first of all, you got to develop trust in yourself, trust in your teammate, trust in your partner. You know, what's your vision? You know, I can go on, but then you got to talk about integrity and that sacrifice. No leader's just sitting on his ass.
Right.
You know what I mean? He's the leader. If you talk about the highest form of leadership, you know, whether it's in a religious sense or, you know, military sense, right?
Right.
You're substituting yours for someone else's life, desires, needs. So, yeah, it was cool how it just kind of took that shape.
And the other thing to me that's very, very cool about it is that you are doing this and perpetuating this in an environment in which it is very much needed. Yeah. Because so many of those characteristics and qualities typically a guy gets from his daddy. He gets from his father. Like, just like it was no accident that you got that from your dad.
Right.
That, you know, in an environment and a family in which there is a father, those things, he leads by example. He shows those things to his children and particularly to his sons by example. And that's not happening now in our world, particularly in sports.
I don't think it's happening. I think there's a lot of places in our world where it's there's a light that's needed. I mean, the cool thing about the way you just framed that too is because I had a father, I had these kind of things that lived in him and in his relationship. Well, there are a lot of young men and women who don't have that, you know, and they may even have a physical father,
right,
but may not even, they still have a void. So for me, from a religious, you know, from a faith-filled standpoint, from that relationship with a heavenly father, right, those things can still be, these are spiritual truth and
absolutely
principles. At
absolutely
the end of the day, they really are.
Absolutely.
That we have to understand, that give us that type of identity. As humans, we're relational people. You know, we're kind of based on relationships.
Right.
So these things kind of help push those and help make those relationships successful, whether it's with God or the people we're working with or our family.
Right.
That's what's important about it.
Mm-hmm. We're going to have more with Allan Houston about Fizzle when we come back with R&R on the other side of this.
Everything I would do, you were standing there by my side, and now you're gonna be with me for the last ride.
It's been a long day without you, my friend, and I'll tell you all about it when I see you again.
This is Allan Houston, and this is my Fizzle moment.
The third fundamental of Fizzle is sacrifice. The sacrifice is yielding to a force that demands denial of self. It's giving over receiving. Are you willing to surrender? Are you willing to commit? Are you willing to have discipline and self-control? Sacrifice is asking the question, what are you willing to do to have something more?
Rolling down the street with my radio on, listen to Funky Politics.
The mayor of the city of Memphis, Mayor Jim Strickland. How are you, sir?
Fantastic.
We keep it real, we keep it right, and we keep it funky.
Funky Politics, part of the Kutsukian Network.
Hey, this is Dr. J.
Hi, this is Rika Ketchum.
This is John Hollinger, Vice President of Basketball Operations for the Memphis Grizzlies.
Tim Brown, NFL Hall of Fame, and Doug T. You are listening to R&R on Sports.
And we are back on R&R. Talking to Allan Houston. And we're talking about this new organization he has formed called Fizzle. And
not Snoop Dogg's Fizzle.
No.
This is Allan Houston's Fizzle.
No, it's not Fizzle for Shizzle. And that, is that how you say
yeah,
it?
Yeah, Fizzle for Shizzle, okay. My nizzle.
You have to be, yeah.
We can say Fizzle for Shizzle.
Yeah. You got to be careful.
Yeah.
Got to be careful. So these principles and whatnot, so how, what's the plan to communicate them and spread them like wildfire?
Well, that's a good question. Fortunately, we have a relationship and a partnership existing now with a company called EverFi. EverFi is a digital technology company. They've helped help create several digital curriculum for schools all over the country.
Mm-hmm.
So we partner with them with their African American Studies curriculum. And so we're taking the Fizzle principles and learning system and merging the Fizzle principles with African American history,
okay,
in several schools. Right now we're in over 40 schools all over the country. Over 600 students will take this Fizzle, and it's called Fizzle 306. 306 was Dr. King's room, as we know,
yeah,
right?
Absolutely.
In the Lorraine, and some other significance to that number. But the thing about Fizzle, which is I get excited about, is it takes on this role of identifying the research and science and success behind experiential learning.
Mm-hmm.
So we learn through this learning cycle of experiential learning. We have a concept, we apply it, mm-hmm, we live it out,
mm-hmm,
and it becomes something that we become more aware of and have, mm-hmm, better understanding of.
Mm-hmm.
If we can continue to promote the message and these principles and values that we can help define in our life, understand where, mm-hmm, faith lives in our life,
mm-hmm,
and how does faith and basketball coexist, how does faith in African American studies, how does faith in science and STEM and math,
mm-hmm,
how does faith live in everything we do, how does integrity live in everything we do. The more we can become aware of that and understand it, the more these things can become kind of second nature,
right,
in our life. And that's the idea of how Fizzle takes on this role of an educational life learning tool that can be partnered with whatever the activity that these students are doing in their life.
Awesome. Now, once again, this is R&R on Sports, and we're speaking with New York Knick, great Allan Houston. Now, you spoke about all these different attributes of these life, life components in order to live a successful life. How do you scale it even more so that more kids can have access to this information, more kids can have the impact of the messages that you're sharing?
Well, that's the process literally we are in now. You know, it becomes something that the more you make it available, the more you craft the best practices, the more research you do on how it's working, what needs to be improved upon. Partnerships are very important.
Right.
And so, you know, I've literally gone to several schools in New York and even worked with some of the guys that I've that are playing now, you know, in the league and, you know, fatherhood programs. So we're really getting a stronger sense of where Fizzle can be applied in the partnerships that it can endure and sustain. What you want to do is you want to have a measurement tool on how that the understanding and the awareness of these principles are being realized. Because we can't go and say, all right, in 10 years, this is what happened to this person.
Right.
But what we can do is I can say the more this person is aware of these things in their life, the better chance they have of becoming second nature.
Right. Are you guys doing a kind of train-the-trainer situation? Because, for example, my son lives in D.C.
Yeah.
And he is part of this mentoring program. This is like his fifth year.
Yeah.
And they are doing fantastic work. But I know that they're kind of coming from the hip. The mentors are teaching the fundamentals of the character traits and characteristics that they were taught from me, and my father and whatnot. So they don't have a plan, so to speak. So are you guys going to be reaching out to mentors and coaches and people who work with young people to train them in the Fizzle way so that they can continue? Is that the plan?
I mean, you hit it right on the head. That's what we have a project right now going on in New York called the Fizzle Project.
Okay.
And, you know, we'd love to try to expand that here in Memphis. And we actually have the same thing going on in Louisville, Kentucky. We have an Allan Houston Mentoring Initiative. The idea of the Fizzle Project is to basically do what you just said. Train those facilitators, whether it's the parents, the leaders, the coaches, those who are running and working directly with the youth, or working directly with student leaders.
Okay.
So these are the first line of that, because what you want the students and the trainers to be able to do is to be able to define these concepts.
Absolutely.
If they can't define them, then how can they realize them and live them
and apply them?
Right. So the training process is about, let's help them define them, help them apply them. In a systematic way. Mm-hmm. You know, what has helped me is now when I speak about any topic in life, or when I speak to my kids or speak to anyone, I have a lens and a framework through which I can see and speak on certain issues and refer back to things just in life. And that's what we really want. Sometimes, you know, with social media, now everyone is their own media entity.
Right.
Everyone has their own media brand.
True. Right.
So if you walk up to anyone on the street and they're their own media brand, then when that camera is on them and they have something to say, what are they going to say and what framework are they going to speak from? You have to have a guided message and a guided plan to speak your message, to increase your brand value.
Mm-hmm.
So what we hope that Fizzle will do is will allow these students to enhance their own media entity, which they all are, if they're on in a media property, mm-hmm. so that their brand integrity, right, and their leadership and their legacy, mm-hmm. and their belief system, you know, and their identity is consistent, mm-hmm. right? So they can live things consistently with through, you know, with what they're actually saying and they're seeing,
right. This is R&R on Sports, and we're speaking with the founder of the Fizzle Project and former New York Knick great, Allan Houston. So, Allan, when you, how could someone, like, say if a principal or someone is listening to the show and they like, man, I really want to get that at my school, yeah. what would be the steps to contacting you guys and then kind of facilitating an opportunity to bring Fizzle to their neck of the woods?
I think the first thing is we have an email set up called the Fizzle Project.
Okay.
At Gmail. Okay. THEFISLL, that's right, two L's.
Yeah.
Right? Project at gmail.com. That's the first, you know, way that we are getting information and resources to say, how interested are you? How, what level of activity, you know, are we able to engage in right away? How much time would we need mm-hmm. to make an assessment of okay. of when we could engage? You know, because again, there's have to be a training and an introduction process. The Fizzle is nothing more or less than a learning tool.
Okay,
it's a learning system, and when these schools that are partnered with Fizzle and EverFi are using it, it's still a project where we're still evaluating, assessing how to best use it, but it right. is a tool that has become valuable because, again, the experiential learning allows them to take the information, the content that they're learning in that class and do a deeper dive and understand it more with more depth through these principles. For example, we do a segment with an African American Histories program. And we talk about the transatlantic slave period.
Okay.
Right.
Right.
So when we talk about that transatlantic slavery period, when we got on those first ships, you know, 600 passengers, if we want to call them passengers. Right.
All right. I'm about to start calling you my man.
Exactly. Yeah. That's what I was kind of leading to, right? Some people are calling them passengers, right? So anyway, you know, 400 of them, you know, literally, you know, half of the slaves wouldn't even make it.
No. Right.
So when you got off that boat, you had to have a certain level of faith, right? Mm-hmm. That this was going to be your new reality, and what does that look like? You know, and that's so we talked about how faith applied even to our identity, even as a people, right? Mm. When we were brought to a land that wasn't even, we weren't even intended to be a human value.
Absolutely.
It was a working value.
And then the other part of that is, letting kids know that they are the descendants of the survivors, which were the strongest psychologically, mentally they were the strongest, physically they were the strongest. They were the survivors. They are descendants of those who made it.
Who made it.
Because all of the ones who did not are on the bottom of the Atlantic at this point. And so they should understand that they That's come from very, very strong stock.
And every one of the fundamentals has seven dimensions. So it's not mm-hmm. just faith. So with faith, the first dimension of faith is identity.
Because mm-hmm.
you have to understand who you are and whose you are,
mm-hmm.
right? To kind of align yourself with the as you move forward through mm-hmm. this process. So, I mean, that's a great insight on that because, again, going back to how you align these principles with whatever they're learning in the classroom or outside of the classroom, that's really where it's embedded.
Right. Right, right.
Man, that is awesome.
It's called the Fizzle Project.
The Fizzle Project.
And to get more information, give them the information again. Right. What do they need to do?
Email thefizzleproject@gmail.com.
All right.
THEFISLL Project.
All right, all right. And Allan, we're going to thank you again, man. But you know, we're gonna keep leaning on the shield.
That's right.
So know this.
The three Kappa man. Three Kappa man.
Know this.
My new pod.
So we're gonna be back at you. And for a return visit and look forward to it. Thank you for being with us. We'll be back with more R&R right after this. Hello, I'm Howard Robertson.
J to the C.
And I am the magnificent, the amazing, the phenomenal Larry Robertson.
All right here on R&R on Sports, on the Sports Byline Network, every Saturday morning.
Yes.
This is the best way to start your weekend.
You catch us, receive us, pass us on to your friends.
Wasn't that cute?
That was
wasn't
nice.
That cute?
We also got some of the best interviews during our iConversation segment.
Every Saturday morning, 11 a.m. Eastern, 10 a.m. Central, 8 a.m. Pacific.
R&R on Sports. Part of the Kazookian Network.
And we are back, but on the way to the door.
I'm going to embody and channel Dr. Harry Edwards. I'm a sports sociologist, and I am going to prescribe a remedy for my Raiders to get back on the good graces, at least for the next 2 years.
And that is what?
Number one, run out there and give Marshawn Lynch, Beast Mode, all the money he wants to come back. And because he's from Oakland, bring him on. Bring him on. People will forget about
that. You can get Beast Mode for money and chips.
The second thing I would do, I'd trade with Seattle, and I'd get Richard Sherman. Third.
Go, Harry.
I would go get me Colin Kaepernick to be behind, and I'd tell him to kneel at every national anthem.
Kneel at everyone.
Yeah, every one of them. That'd be your thing. That's next to saluting, you can Colin Kaepernick.
I hear you.
And that way, the Raiders would get back in everybody's good graces, at least for those people in Oakland, for the next 2 years.
All right. Now, my shout-out goes to Dustin Johnson.
Dustin Johnson.
I want to quote my late great daddy, who used to say, "Dustin, you know it's just always something to come along and kick joy in the ass." Know you've been on a roll, know you've been doing well, and then you fall down some steps at the rental house.
He was wearing, to never wear fresh tube socks on a hardwood floor.
Hey. That's
asking.
Here's what you need to do next. What you need to do next is put in a call to Shaq. He can get you a great deal on a couple of gallons of Icy Hot. And just lay it on, baby. All right. And with that, we're going to get out of here. Be sure to tune in and get us on
everything.
We're on all the platforms.
Your podcast provider. Just go and Google us.
And get at us. You can stream us on sportsbyline.com. 9 a.m. Eastern, 10 a.m. Central every Saturday morning. And with that, we're going to say later. Y'all take care of yourselves and take care of each other.
Actually, that was 11 a.m. Eastern, 10 a.m. Central.
That's exactly what it is. That's what I said. Y'all take care. Be good.
Peace.
R&R on Sports is recorded live at LPI Studios in the heart of Memphis, Tennessee. Web designer Daniel Coates, executive producer Larry Robinson, written by Howard Robertson, and produced by Reggie Fine. R&R on Sports, part of the Kazookian Network.